So creatine is probably the most researched fitness supplement, and yet there still seems to be a lot of confusion surrounding it, particularly with beginners. And while I don't really talk about supplements on this channel, creatine has a very proven track record. So if you're looking to increase your strength and muscle gain, I'm going to explain what creatine is, address some concerns you might have, and what it can realistically do for you. So first of all, let's get the boring part out of the way. Creatine is basically a compound that's composed of 3 amino acids, and the vast majority of it is stored in your skeletal muscle. When you work out, the energy you use is when a molecule called ATP breaks down into ADP. However, your muscles only store enough ATP for you to perform high intensity exercises for a few seconds. This is where creatine comes in. It basically regenerates ATP to extend the amount of time you can perform exercises at a high level of intensity. I think you can already tell where I'm going with this. By supplementing with creatine, you can improve exercise performance, which ultimately leads to more strength and muscle gain. But do you really need to use a supplement? Well, as far as internal creatine stores go, your liver produces about 1 gram a day, and you get about another gram of creatine from your food, mainly through animal foods such as beef, chicken, and seafood. However, if you want to saturate your muscles with creatine, you need to consume about 3 to 5 grams per day consistently. Consuming this amount solely from your diet is actually pretty impractical, if not downright impossible. For context, you'd need to eat about 2 pounds of steak just to get 4 grams of creatine. And honestly, it's probably less than that since cooking meat does degrade its creatine content. So unless you plan on eating raw meats, which I don't advise, or eating 2 pounds of it per day, supplementation makes the most practical sense. So if you're interested in using creatine, let's go over a few things you may have heard that's still keeping you on the fence. First things first, there is nothing illicit about the use of creatine. Among beginners, there's this sense of mystery surrounding creatine, almost to the point where it's seen as an anabolic substance. Now obviously the use of creatine will result in muscle and strength gains, but it doesn't provide gains even close to the magnitude of what you observe in enhanced athletes. What creatine does is simply top off your muscle storage so that you can push yourself just a bit further than you previously could. Let's say you can bench press 185 pounds for 8 reps. With creatine saturation, you'll probably find that you can bench press 185 pounds for 10 reps. Now, of course, when it comes to any supplement, you want to make sure there is a level of safety involved. And the biggest concern for most people are kidney function, hair loss, and weight gain. Creatine's effect on kidney function has actually been very positive among individuals without any pre-existing kidney disease. In fact, one study indicated that dosing as high as 30 grams per day over the course of 5 years showed no negative effects. For the purposes of resistance training, you wouldn't even be taking that amount anyway. Creatine's effect on hair loss is also unclear. A study performed back in 2009 showed that the usage of creatine among college-age rugby players increased DHT, which is a contributor to the development of baldness. However, there has not been another study to date that replicates the results from the one in 2009. Furthermore, the increase in DHT still kept it within normal range of DHT levels. The conclusion that creatine drives hair loss is just not an established correlation and should really be of little concern since there hasn't been another study replicated. My interpretation is this: the current body of evidence doesn't have enough support to definitively say that creatine causes hair loss. The last concern that most people have is weight gain, and I want to take the time to mention that there is a huge difference between weight gain and fat gain. You can gain weight if you gain muscle, and I'm sure people would not be opposed to that. But for those of you who are using creatine while trying to lose fat, if you see an increase in the scale, and you will, it's because creatine draws water into your muscles. So that extra weight you see is water weight, not fat. However, I think what concerns people even more is that they think this water weight will give you a puffy or bloated appearance. But you have to understand that water is drawn into the muscles to increase cellular volume. If anything, it will give you a more muscular look. You can expect about a 1 to 3% increase in body weight from the increased amount of water, but if anything, this will only be a benefit in your gym performance. When it comes to dosing with creatine, there are two options: a loading phase where you take 20 to 25 grams of creatine a day for a week, and then after that week you consume 5 grams every day, or a regular phase where you just consume 5 grams of creatine every day. The difference is that a loading phase will saturate your muscles with creatine much faster than a normal phase, but it may come at the cost of some stomach discomfort. Whichever option you choose is really up to you because the end result will be the same, which is muscle creatine saturation. However, what's important is your continual use of creatine. I've tried both phases and neither of them made much of a difference for me, provided that I use it for the long term. Speaking of long term, one thing I also want to mention is that timing of creatine ingestion really isn't as important when used consistently. Studies have shown that taking creatine post-workout with a high carbohydrate meal is probably superior than taking it before workout, but those benefits mainly appear during the first 2 weeks of using creatine, where your goal is to fully saturate your muscles. Once you receive that level of saturation, creatine timing doesn't really have any sort of meaningful impact. What this means is that you're playing the long game with creatine. A loading phase and a normal phase are just two different starting points that ultimately take you to the same destination. Most sources I was able to find recommend using creatine for up to 3 months and then taking a 1 month break before getting back on. It's unlikely that using creatine indefinitely has any negative side effects, but for certain sports with weight categories, taking a break from creatine might be necessary to drop some of that water weight before competition. The bottom line, though, is when you stop taking creatine, you'll return to baseline levels in about 4 to 6 weeks. The last thing I want to go over is choosing the type of creatine. I hate to say this, but most supplements are just not going to be able to deliver what they promise. But creatine is one of those few supplements that actually works well and is also backed by decades of research. However, even among creatine, there are so many different forms. The most common and recommended is creatine monohydrate, and it's the most stable and widely studied form. It's also the cheapest form of creatine. The general consensus is that other forms of creatine will not provide superior benefits or effects relative to their increase in cost when compared to creatine monohydrate. So to sum it up, creatine is just a molecule that our bodies can synthesize on its own, but supplementing with it can improve strength and muscle mass. Creatine has been studied so extensively that all signs point to it providing substantial benefits without any detrimental effects on healthy individuals. When it comes to creatine, you're playing the long game here, so the timing of it or the choice between a loading phase versus a normal phase is honestly trivial and should be left up to your preference. Because creatine improves your strength, it's useful during a cutting or bulking phase, and you can take a break when you're just maintaining calories, but there's probably no harm in taking it during a maintenance phase either. Creatine monohydrate is not only the cheapest form of creatine, but also the most heavily researched and the most recommended. Anyway, I hope this video provided you with some insight on what creatine is, and maybe gave you some more realistic expectations of what it can and can't do. This isn't some miracle pill, but as far as supplements go, it's one that's tried and true, and also practical. Anyway, that's it for today's session. Let me know if you have any thoughts or questions in the comments section. If you found this video helpful, consider crushing that like button and subscribe to the channel. But until then, I'll see you all next time.